seen, open?
Yeah, that's really cool.
Once I had seen that bit of footage, I knew that I had to have that for myself. Because my car had always had some issues getting up to temperature, especially in the winter months, rarely reaching above, let's say, 40 degrees centigrade of water temp. I did a little research online and discovered that these radiator shutters were actually quite a thing back then. Before the thermostat was invented, you basically used any kind of piece of cloth or metal, anything to cover up partways of your radiator. And in order to make things a little bit more convenient when temperatures should vary during the day or night time, some of these were even adjustable. A company named Pines specialized in making these for aftermarket accessories. For example, you could strap these down to your average Buick or Plymouth or even a Model A if you wanted to. They had different sizes and varied in their design. Most of them actually had a bimetal integrated into them, so as the car warmed up, the louvers would slowly start opening. They are pretty rare to come by in Germany. Well, to be honest, I haven't even seen any of them in real life yet, but I wanted to have one. So it's obviously bang in the face to me that I had to make one myself. I tried, I didn't succeed. That's what I want to bring right up front. This video is not ending with a working radiator shutter. I did a poll, and you guys wanted me to show it anyways. I'm not ditching the project at all. This was just one attempt, which didn't work. And I'm, you know, going to keep thinking about making the design I had maybe stronger or more rigid or more tolerant towards clearance. And you know, start thinking about it, see what I can come up with, which actually works. The shutter mechanism is actually quite an intricate feature. I didn't make it easy on myself either. I wanted vertical louvers and I wanted to have them open symmetrically. So rather than have, say, 20, 40 louvers all going into one direction, I wanted them to open like this. That meant, for example, putting a gear mechanism in there to make one do the mirror image of the other. I needed some kind of linkage to link all the individual leaves together. And of course I needed some kind of actuating mechanism to tell the shutter blades what they should do. In addition, I had quite a couple of external constraints. I couldn't just mount this thing anywhere on the radiator and expect it to work. So I had to take some measurements and had to think about where I wanted to mount it, how I wanted to mount it. And that basically resulted in making a computer model of the thing. And that is where things start getting iffy. The problem is that on the computer many things will work which won't in real life. So I decided that because the parts were quite complicated and had to be precise and most importantly identical to each other, and there were very many of them, I decided to send things out. For the first time I outsourced making parts to a third party and a fourth one as well. I had the individual shutter blades and the frame laser cut, and the little pivots were machined by an outside machine shop. So I had all the shutter blades there. I had, you know, made them into a pattern which I could just basically cut them out of. And when I went and wanted to assemble it, I discovered that the blades were actually too large. You can see it in the model right there how they touch upon closing. I thought about, you know, whittling away at every individual louver and making it thinner a little bit, but all the different approaches I tried weren't really successful. Running it over the grinder, trying it in the shaper, not really. The 1 mm sheet metal would start flexing and bending and you would end up with a crooked shutter blade. So instead I decided to make the concession and say, alright, it's not going to close all the way. Who the hell cares? To fix the shutter to the car, I decided to mount it in between the radiator cover and the radiator itself. There are little latches which attach the cover to the radiator, and there was enough air or flexibility in between to just, you know, squeeze 2 mm of extra sheet in between. The lugs worked out fine, however I designed the frame too large in order to fit in between, so I had to chuck that one up in the shaper as well and reduce it in thickness a little. Every hole in the entire contraption was laser cut, and for the tiny 1mm rivet holes, that was enough. I was surprised at, you know, how well it was possible to rivet these guys later on, but the hinges of the thing needed to be reamed all individually for the small pins to fit. Took a little time, but my flexible dentist drill did the job just fine. I'll also have to make the second bend on these pieces here, because the company that I ordered all this stuff from, they're all like,
"Ew, these are so tiny, we can't bend them, ew."
And that right there is where the whole project was basically doomed to fail from now on in. These tiny little pieces are what link every individual shutter blade to the next one, coordinate their movement so they do exactly the same. And in order for this to work, you basically have to have everything spot on. The distances in the holes need to be the same. The distances of the little levers which had to be bent, exactly the same. The positions of the individual levers on the shutter blades to the next one, exactly the same. And so on and so on. And by bending them myself, I basically, you know, brought a whole big variable in there which made every lever just that tiny bit different. But, you know, if we are talking about 1/10, 2/10, half a millimeter even, that's way too much if you have just a fit of, shall we say, 500s or so tolerance of the little pins in the guide rail. Anyways, I decided to continue. There's a whole lot of riveting coming up, and I'm just going to, you know, throw the fast forwarding at you, and maybe you'll get a glimpse at what I've been doing here.
Thank you. Come and cuddle by the fire in the evening. We'll forget about the snow and rain. While the skies are storming, your arms will warm me. It's winter again. It's so thrilling when it's chilly in the winter, and the frost is on the window pane. Hear the sleigh bells ring, my heart is singing. It's winter again. The wind may blow, who cares, just let it blow. I'll write to you love letters in the snow. Then we'll cuddle by the fire in the evening. We'll forget about the snow and rain. While the skies are stormy, your arms will warm me. It's winter again.
I am now to a point where I can proudly say this won't work. It's all together and it is rock solid. I mean, you can't even get a little twist out of any of these guys. Then I've discovered this is way too flimsy. Imagine the power of, you know, 80 kilometers an hour of wind battling against this. It's just not going to like it. It's going to be noisy as hell waiting at a traffic light with this all rattling about. And, well, let me show you why it won't work. The problem, I think, is that these hands here bend each one of these levers, and these are the most important part of the mechanism because they control how each individual louver here is connected to every other one. And with the position of each one of them, the geometric position or relation to each other is determined. Now, when we take a peek at this here, each one has a different angle to it. That's because these weren't machine bent to be exactly the same. These are all different because I bent them in a vise and held them crooked and cut them apart and whatnot. You can also see that they are so much under tension that some of these are trying to deflect away while others stay rather perpendicular. In other words, this whole thing is under tension right now. Not much, but enough, of course, to make these fragile little pins here want to bind up and bend, and if I would try to force it, probably even break. This is way too thin material, the pins as well, so every little deviation here is going to cause things to bind. And it's not going to get better with different temperatures, with, as I said, the wind while driving along, with salt and grime and rain and whatnot getting into it. It's just, it was doomed to fail from the get-go, I think. And yeah, for now, no amount of duct tape can fix this design. As much as it hurts, this is all just scrap metal right now. And for me, it's back to the drawing board. Now, as I said, that isn't the end of the story here. I'm going to finish the thing up and put it up in the garage as some kind of decorative art. I'm going to go back to the drawing board, see which other designs will work out. And, you know, I've learned quite a lot from that. There is two ways to go here. Number one would be to keep the design that I have and make it more sturdy, more rigid, less louvers, for example. And the other would be to go a whole different route. I had the leather cover before, so why not mount it up to a spring-loaded roll, for example, and have it like a curtain to move up and down with, a chain or a rope or something like that. I'll have to, while the car is still apart, take some measurements and see what's going to be feasible, what makes most sense. And until then, it might take a while, might take a couple of months, probably will take a couple of months until I revisit that. In the meantime, it's going to be probably summer, and then I won't really need it, so, you know, probably plan in a year or so until you hear from this project again. Do you know what? This is actually a great opportunity for me to say, if you want to stay tuned on the project, then subscribe to the channel and come back next year. So this is what it would have or could have looked like. Painted black possibly to make it look less striking. That would have been the idea. That's a great